Let's talk about how to evaluate logs, which is short for logarithms, and why they are useful. So if somebody tells you, for example, that 2 to the third is equal to 8, well, that's definitely a true statement, right? 2 cubed is equal to 8. Now, that same information could be told to you in the following way. Log base 2 of 8 is equal to 3. So this is called the first equation is called the exponential form. And we're familiar with exponential forms. The second equation is what's called the logarithmic form. And you might say, well, what does it mean? And the answer is, these mean the same thing. These are equivalent, okay? Here the information is given to you exponentially. Here the information is given to you logarithmically. Now, what do they have in common? That number 2 right there in the log, that's the base. We call that the base of the logarithm. And of course, the base of the exponential is also a 2, right? So the logarithm and or the logarithm and the exponential have the same base. Now the difference is that if, you know, this is obvious, 2 cubed is equal to 8. The logarithm, the way we think about this is as follows. You take the base, 2, and you raise it to the other side of the equation. Whoa. So 2 cubed, and then you set it equal to that. That's really confusing, right? 2 to the third is equal to 8. And that says the same thing here. 2 to the third is equal to 8. Let's try another one. Let's go the other way. Let's say you add log base 4 of 16 is equal to 2. Do you see why that's true? Well, because the way you undo a logarithm, if you will, is you start with the base, which is a 4, right? And you raise it to the other side of the equation. That's the trick. And you get a 2, and then it's equal to whatever is there in here, which is called the argument of the logarithm, and that's equal to 16. So both of these statements are true, right? They convey the same information. One is given logarithmically, the top one, and the other one's given exponentially. Okay, so with that in mind, sometimes you're asked to evaluate a log. Now, looking at this, right, what's the right-hand side of the logarithm? Isn't it the exponent, right? So 2 is the exponent that you have to raise the base to get 16. So when I look at this, it's like saying, huh, 3 raised to what gives 9? And that's why this has got to be equal to 2. Why? Because 3 squared gives 9. You see that? Let's try this next one. Log base 5 of 1 over 25. That one's a little harder, right? If I say, I'm not sure, I'm going to call that x. What has to be true? Well, 5 raised to the x, right? The x, the right-hand side of a logarithm is an exponent. That's got to be equal to 1 over 25. And now the question is, can you think of an x? Well, not 2, because 5 squared is 25. But how about negative 2? Oh yeah, because 5 to the negative second, right, is 1 over 5 squared. And that's equal to 1 over 25. Okay, so that means x is equal to negative 2. So log base 5 of 1 over 25 is equal to negative 2. Now this one, it looks like the base is missing, right? The first one, the base was a 3. The second one, the base was a 5. Here, there's no base written. When that happens, this is called the common logarithm. So a common log is one where it looks like the base is missing. But the base is really a 10. Nobody writes it. Okay, it's kind of like this, the square root, right? We know there's the cube root, but whenever the index is missing, it's really a 2, even if people don't really, we never really write this, right? You assume it's a 2. Same thing here, you assume it's a 10. So the question is, 10 raised to what gives 100? Wouldn't that be 2? So the common logarithm actually appears on your calculator. So if you take a calculator on your phone or your computer, or if you have one of those old traditional calculators, if you push log of 100, you'll find your calculator gives 2, because your calculator is telling you that 10, right, squared is 100. 10 is really the base of the logarithm if it's not written in, okay? So these are how you evaluate logarithms. Now you might be asking yourself, why would anybody do this? 2 to the third is equal to 8. That's very clear. Why would I make things more confusing and focus on notation that gave me the exponent, right? What's the advantage of thinking about the exponent, right? 3 squared is equal to 9, but why write this in a confusing way? Likewise, 10 squared is 100, but why focus on the exponent? And I'm glad you asked. Let's go ahead and look at some applications. Let's talk about astronomy. So let's say that you were looking into the sky and you noticed a few things. Let's say you noticed the, let's start off with the sun, our buddy. Okay? And when you looked at the sun, what we're going to be doing is we're going to be looking at distances. So that we're going to consider some object with and think about their distance from Earth. So distances. So the sun from Earth, let's say you were just looking at, there was some sun. Well, our sun isn't quite this distance, but let's say it was approximately this distance. 1 over 100,000 light years away. Okay, now you might say that's confusing. It says years, and that's time. Light years is actually a distance. It's how far light travels in 1 year. So one light year is actually a distance. And let's say you were thinking about a sun that's one over 100,000 light years away. Now, 1 over 100,000, right? That's the same as 10 to the negative fifth, writing this in scientific notation. So you had the sun, and let's say you were also looking at something, some sort of cloud way out there. And let's say the cloud was actually 1 light year away. Or how about we make that 10, just to make it a little easier, 10 light years away. Okay, and then finally you had some distant galaxy way out there. And let's say the galaxy you observed was, how about 1 million light years away? So way out there. Okay, now 1 million, right, is 10 to the sixth. Okay, now here's the problem. Let's say that you wanted to convey this information to a friend. You on one chart, you wanted to tell her how far the sun, the cloud, and the galaxy were away. Now by cloud, I don't mean just a cloud floating in the sky right here. I mean maybe a cloud full of little planetesimals way out there, okay? So you wanted to tell your friend how far these things away were away, but graphically, you wanted to represent it visually. Here's the problem. If you think about light years, right? 1 over 100,000 light years, that's a tiny little fraction of 1 light year, right? So compare that with 10 light years. Well, 10's a lot bigger than 1 over 100,000. Compare 10, though, with 1 million. 1 million's a lot bigger than 10, and 10's a lot bigger than 1 over 100,000. So the problem is this. If you go to represent distance here, the scales are all out of whack, right? Because, first of all, if you put 10, let's say you call this 10. Well, 10, 20, 30, 40. There's clearly a problem. Where are you going to put 1 million? Way up here, right? It's impractical. Where are you going to put 1 over 100,000? So the problem is that these numbers that may arise naturally in astronomy, they're so vastly different. The range of the numbers is so huge, right? Tiny to huge, but it's all part of the same phenomenon. So the question is, what do you do? And the answer is, you focus on the exponent, okay? You focus on the negative 5, and here the exponent for the cloud would be a 1, and here the exponent would be a 6. That is, you take the logarithm, okay? You don't look at 10 to the negative 5th, you look at the log, let's call this the common log of 10 to the negative 5th, okay? And remember what the log does, it allows you to focus on the exponent. So this is going to be negative 5. Why? Because remember, common log has a base of 10, and 10 to the negative 5 is 10 to the negative 5. So when you take the log of these numbers, you're focusing on the exponent. So when I do this, when I take log of this, that gives me just 1, right? So log of 10 is just 1, because 10 to the first is 10. And likewise for this last one, log of 10 to the sixth, that is 6. So then I can say, hey, let's look at negative 5, 1, and 6 on the chart. So let's see, let's go ahead and do that. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Negative 1, negative 2, negative 3, negative 4, negative 5, right? So the sun we're looking at, I'm going to put a negative 5 for the sun, so right here. And then the cloud way out there, right? I'm going to put a 1, so C for cloud, and a 1. And the galaxy, G for galaxy, I'm going to put a 6, so way up here. Now, my reader will be very confused if I just say distance. It's not distance, right? Because the distance was like 1 over 100,000. What did I do to the distance? I took the log of the distance. So we tell our reader this: don't just take distance, take the log of the distance, okay? Measured in light years. And so what happens is when you transmit this information to your friend sees that word log, and they know that these all represent the these numbers on the y-axis all represent exponents. So they see the negative 5 and they think, oh, that's really 10 to the negative fifth light years. And they see the 1 and they say, oh, that's really 10 to the first light years. And they see the 6 and they say, that's really 10 to the sixth light years. So logs are a way of encoding phenomenon that have huge variations, something you might run into in astronomy. Can you think of another field where you might see huge variations? I'm thinking something like geology. Let's take a look at that now. So let's look at the grand, think about the Grand Canyon. Now, the Grand Canyon, as you know, it's grand, it's very deep. Now, it turns out rocks on the bottom of, you might find rocks on the bottom of the Grand Canyon that are, well, really old. One, maybe 1 billion. Not million, 1 billion light years old. Or not light years, but 1 billion years old. Okay? So 1 billion years. What is that in scientific notation? Wouldn't that be 10 to the, well, how many zeros do I have? 9. So rocks that are 10 to the ninth years old. That's pretty old. Okay? And then so that might be at the bottom of the Grand Canyon. And then as you hike your way up, let's say you're halfway. And they're still old, right? But let's say you find rocks that are 1 million years old. Old, but not 1 billion. Okay, so 1 million years old is 10 to the sixth, okay, years old. And then at the top of the Grand Canyon, right, that is on the surface where you might people walk around at the top, you know, in visitor center and so on, you might find a rock that's only 10 years old, okay, and that's 10 to the first. And so you can see again what a huge range, right? 10 versus 1 million versus 1 billion, right? This massive range makes it impractical to scale. So what geologists do is they say, let's not look at the time. Let's not look at the time measured in years before present. Let's do this. Let's take the log of the time. Okay? And when you take the log of something, that makes you focus on the exponents. So the 1, the 6, and the 9. Now let me write 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, and 0. Now this says years before present, right? So somebody reading this says, oh, okay, log, that means these are exponents. So right here, this is 10 to the ninth years before present. That's 1 billion years before the present, right? Right here, 10 to the sixth, 1 million years before present, right there. So this was 1 billion years before present. And then the rock at the top might be right here, right? Because it's 10 to the first or 10 years before present. Now, often in applications, people don't really write, unfortunately, the log like this. Often they just write time, and then off to the side, they write log. And you have to know that it's log of the time, okay? And it's really about focusing on the exponents. Okay, so that's how we evaluate logs, and those are a couple of places where logs are useful. Now, be on the lookout for logs also to appear in chemistry. And maybe your chemistry teacher will teach you about something called pH. And pH is defined in terms of logs. Okay, so logs appear quite frequently. Until next time.